Okay, just to tell you, I will not be looking into my chat box, and like I will be talking, giving the presentation. So if you have any questions and you have put something, just give me a thumbs up and I will stop and ask if you cannot hear me well, if you have some query. Otherwise, we will have a detailed discussion session at the end where you can ask me questions regarding the topic today we are discussing, and we can have a good chat at the end. So let's begin with this. So I first of all, good evening, a warm welcome to all the first timers, and a big shout out to the patrons of Curious Minds community. I thank you all for your interest in science and wish you all a very happy and healthy 2023. Today we are discussing the science behind motivation. So as always, I will start with the presentation and the meetup will be open to all for questions and discussion. So first of all, I will give you the fundamental knowledge about the motivational drivers, types of motivation, and then we will move on to the scientific basis of motivation, where we will learn about how certain chemicals produced in the brain influence motivation. And please stick to the end to learn science-based tips and tools which you can easily employ to increase and sustain motivation. I promise to make it all clear and accessible, regardless of whether or not you have a scientific background. So before that, let me introduce myself. I'm a cancer immunologist. I also write two newsletters which are free to subscribe. Do check out if interested. Details are here. And recently, I have started Science Book Club on Meetup. So this month's book is by Wendy Suzuki, Happy Brain, Happy Life. It's a very interesting book to read. So if you are interested, you can join me there. It will be an online book meetup. So now let's get to motivation. So what is the definition of motivation? Motivation comes from the word motive, which denotes a person's needs, desires, wants, or urges. It has three components. So number one, activation, persistence, and intensity. So the degree of which these components of motivation can impact whether you achieve your goal. So strong activation, for example, means that you are more likely to start pursuing a goal. Persistence and intensity will determine if you keep working towards that goal and how much effort you devote to reaching it. The hardest part is actually to start. Getting started, even in very small ways, naturally produces momentum. This effect is actually called physics of productivity. That is, objects in motion tend to stay in motion. Once the task has begun, it is easier to continue moving it forward. And to stay motivated for the long run, one should follow Goldilocks rule. What is that? It is based on the fact that humans experience peak motivation when working on tasks that are right on the edge of their current abilities. Not too hard, not too easy, just right. So now, what are the drivers that motivate us to do things? According to psychologists, self-determination theory explains this. The theory splits between two core types of motivational drivers, external and internal. You do some things as a means to an end for money, self-esteem, or because fear of punishment. For example, these are called the external motivators. And you do other things because you truly identify with them. You derive a sense of inherent purpose, identity, or pleasure from that action. These are called internal motivators. So based on these drivers, motivation can be classified into six different categories. So A motivation, as the name suggests, it means lack of motivation or any action taken. It happens when you have no immediate internal or external reason to do the thing. And then it's the external, the carrot and the stick. So behavior is only done to receive a reward or to avoid punishment. If this was no longer there, you would no longer do it. And then there is introjected motivation, which drags in your ego. Think of it as an internal reward or punishment. If you do it, you will feel proud. If you don't, you feel you have let yourself down or aren't living up to your expectations. And then the fourth is identified. An action is taken because it is consciously valued by you and links to your personal goals. Then it's integrated. The action taken is a core part of your identity. And then intrinsic, it is more visible in your hobbies. So these motivational types provide a framework to realize which is your driving force. It will consciously adjust to healthier motivational state. It will give you an idea of what is driving you. Okay, folks, this isn't going to be some pumped up motivational speech. So let us switch gears. Wear our science glasses and break down the science behind how to get motivated in the first place and how to stay motivated for the longer run. So let's ask this question again. What drives motivation? It is dopamine. Dopamine is a currency and it's the way that you track pleasure, track success, track whether or not you are going well or poorly. So when dopamine levels are low, we will feel unmotivated, derive less pleasure from pursuits and feel physically tired. So dopamine also controls movement and coordination. It is a molecule of anticipation. It is a molecule of pleasure and it gives you a time perception. So it does a lot of things. So how this molecule is doing it all? So it's a neuromodulator. Neuromodulators are some chemicals which influences the communication of many neurons at once. So if you can see this figure on the left, on the right side, so these are two neurons talking to each other. So neurons talk by releasing chemicals, which are known as neurotransmitters. But dopamine is actually a neuromodulator, which simply means that if it is released, its action is carried on by many number of neurons. So it is affecting many neurons at one time. So now, while dopamine promotes many critical brain capacities and states, only about 1% of the neurons in the brain can actually make dopamine. It's essential that these relatively few neurons be protected and supported if we want to achieve and sustain peak brain performance throughout our lifespan. We must have adequate dopamine levels to function properly. So now, dopamine is carrying all these functions. So it works by three major signaling pathways. I should alert you that there will be some big mouthy science words now coming, but don't fret. You don't need to remember them. Just understand their functions. It will give you the idea how this 1% dopamine producing neurons controls so many important activities. Look at this left figure where it is showing the three major pathways, which are actually denoted by three different colors, red, blue, and green. So I will just go through them. So the major dopamine producing region of the brain is the midbrain. So this is your midbrain. So which contains the vast majority of the dopamine producing neurons. Within this midbrain, the substantia nigra is the most important dopamine cluster of neurons. And it's important for your movement and reflexes. So this is the first function of the dopamine, your movement and reflexes. And this is the region which gets depleted. The neurons in this region gets depleted in patients who suffer from Parkinson's or depression. So this is the major region which gets depleted there. The second is the ventral tegmental area, which is another region in the midbrain. Its projection goes through the nucleus accumbens, olfactory, amygdala, and hippocampus. So all these regions, amygdala, hippocampus, you must have heard somewhere. These are the regions of the brain which affects the stress response, which affects the memory response. So this is the region where dopamine neurons are clustered. So this will this plays a major role in the reward. And it's the motivational component of the reward-motivated behavior and behavioral reinforcement and perception of pleasure. So all this region is responsible for your motivational behavior. And this region will actually tells you if you do certain thing and it gave you pleasure, this region will remember and tells you to do it more. Or when you will come back to it, it will give you the same kind of pleasure again. So it because it's going through the regions which are actively involved in the memory making process, which is the your hippocampus. So then there is a third brain region, which is called the mesocortical dopaminergic pathway, which is involved in cognitive control, behavioral flexibility, and emotional resilience, because it is passing through your prefrontal cortex, this blue region. So prefrontal cortex is the region which makes the all the decisions. No need to worry about this. Only remember these three important pathways and their functions. And few important points more, which I want to highlight here. So dopamine actually communicates through GPCR, which is G protein coupled receptors. Why this is important? Because these receptors take a longer time to kick in and they can actually impact the gene expression. So it can make a permanent change in your brain and permanent change in the activity. And dopamine also is influenced by glutamate. So when dopamine is released, another neurotransmitter, another chemical which crosstalks between the neurons or pass the message to other neurons is glutamate, which is also released together with dopamine. So glutamate is very important for the health of our brain. So just remember these important things. It will help you to understand when I will tell you about the scientific tools and tips. So now, while this might seem all complicated, the key things to remember are dopamine has big effects despite being made in only small areas of the brain, because the dopamine pathways connect to areas of the brain affecting voluntary and involuntary muscle movements. It has effect on the reward processes, executive functions, your associative learning, and motor control. So dopamine is doing all this. And it also helps our brain to recognize incentive salience so that we can red flag our neurochemistry to do that feel-good thing again. So it is playing really critical role, and we should know how to balance dopamine activity in our body and brain. And we will talk about this. So in an evolutionary sense, dopamine signals our brain to continuously chase that trigger, better, newer, shining, shinier thing over there. So if you just go back in time and think about the hunter-gatherers, so hunter-gatherers have to go out in the wild to gather food. So if the dopamine signal is not there, a person will not move, because the person knows that there are too many dangers outside. But this, because of this dopamine signal, this is an evolutionary signal which we have, a person is motivated to go out and take the risk. So dopamine is evolutionary very important. But and more importantly, dopamine deficiency can link to conditions such as Parkinson's, as I talked it before, Lewy body dementia, restless leg syndrome, depression, schizophrenia, and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. These all disorders and many more are actually linked with the deficiency of dopamine. But what happens when we disturbs this dopamine balance in our body? So very important to understand is that dopamine works in a pleasure pain balance system. So as you can understand, dopamine is giving you the pleasure, is the anticipation hormone, anticipation neuromodulator. But there is a balance in your body. So neurologically, pleasure and pain are processes in overlapping brain region. So this is a very new discovery, which tells you that in the same region, you will feel the pleasure, and in the same region, there will be receptors for pain. So they work in a seesaw mechanism. So when the balance tips towards pleasure, the system reflexively self-regulates to bring its level again. So To understand this, when we have easy access to food, social media, porn, entertainment, games, etc., all the things which are giving you pleasure, this relentless pursuit of pleasure tilts the dopamine seesaw towards the direction of pain. And it reduces your ability to experience pleasure. And when high levels of dopamine spike is always followed, actually this dopamine spike is always followed by a drop in dopamine levels, even below the baseline. So we all have a baseline dopamine level in our body. And when we indulge in all these dopamine enhancing activities, it is actually followed by a dip in dopamine, which is below our baseline levels. This is actually known as the dopamine set point, the baseline level. And when it dips towards it dips, we feel the pain and the urge to follow the pleasure pathway, and which leads to a vicious cycle of addiction. So addiction actually creates a tolerance, and a high dopamine tolerance, we lose motivation and passion. Seeking pleasure for pleasure's sake eventually tilts the neurochemical seesaw in favor of compensatory pain. That's why chasing easy dopamine hits leaves us feeling depressed and shitty. All these Naval Ravikant, he tells this modern devil is cheap dopamine, which is our social media and a lot of things like even porn, entertainment, games, online games. All these are giving us instant gratification, instant pleasure, and increasing our dopamine levels, which are followed by this pain pathway, the tipping of seesaw. So this is how it works, and it leads to addiction, and this addiction feeling leads to depression because we lose the urge or a desire to pursue even small things. So it's all this vicious cycle starts acting on. Okay, so these are the examples of certain foods and drugs that tip the pleasure-pain balance. So even the chocolate, it increases the dopamine level by 55%. Sexual pleasures, 100%. Nicotine, 150%. Cocaine, 225%. And amphetamine, 1,000%. So you can understand that the drug which will increase the dopamine level to a higher percentage will give you the pain response in the same magnitude and will be addicted in the same way. So now, giving all that scientific background, now let's just move on into the science-backed tips and tools which can help you to sustain motivation and which can help you to maintain the dopamine levels. To just give you a background again, we all have a baseline dopamine, and it can spike or drop based on various actions, compounds we ingest, or even our thoughts. Our baseline dopamine levels are influenced by many factors, including genetics, behavior, sleep, nutrition, and the level of dopamine you experience the previous day. It is critically important to maintain sufficient levels of baseline dopamine to sustain day-to-day motivation. We don't want the baseline too low or too high. So now let's understand what we can do to sustain motivation. Number one, very easy, viewing early morning sunlight for 10 to 30 minutes. So don't wear sunglasses for this and don't stare at the sun directly. This causes the release of dopamine. If done consistently, it will also increase levels of gene expression for certain dopamine receptors. And even on cloudy days, there is sun. So there are UV signals there. So there is sun. And if there is like cloudy day for long days, it is going on, you can actually go for Hilux 9K to 10K light pad, which is easily available on Amazon, and keep it at home. And you can have this morning ritual of just 10 minutes of sunlight or this exposure to this light pad, which is very good and scientifically backed that it will increase the dopamine and it will also regulate your circadian rhythm. Number two, very easy to do, cold shower. 1 to 3 minutes, depending upon your cold tolerance, and it will increase the baseline. And more importantly, it increases 2.5x times and for long periods. So up to 3 hours, it has been seen that dopamine levels are increased. So most of the things increases dopamine for short time, but cold water actually increases for like a long period, up to 3 hours. So early morning cold shower is good. Cold plunge, just I know it's winters and hearing about the cold shower is not good, but if you want to start with this, try from spring and you will see major difference. Or if you are doing a hot shower, just go for 30 seconds of cold after that. It will also make a big difference. So I have given this whole presentation on the effects of cold and hot in the past, and I can share the slides in the group if someone is interested to know the scientific reason how this happens. But one of the major factor is the dopamine spike in the body, and it continues for up to 3 hours, which is very important. The third is eat tyrosine-rich foods. Why tyrosine-rich foods? Because tyrosine is the molecule which gets converted into dopamine. So vegetarians, non-vegetarians, everyone can get tyrosine from different kinds of food and red meats or hard fermented cheese, parmesan, etc. are very rich in tyrosine. And for vegetarian, nuts, avocados, bananas are rich in tyrosine. So the fourth is avoid melatonin supplements. So melatonin is actually used, like it is available on the counter, but it should not be used generously anytime when you want. Very rarely you should use, because melatonin is actually a hormone and it can do a lot of things in your body. So if you look in this picture, just see these three things. Light is actually so in our body we have a biological clock which works according to the light. So when we are active in the day, dopamine is high in our body, and during night dopamine levels go down and melatonin levels go up. And melatonin and dopamine are both antagonists, so melatonin will decrease the levels of dopamine and dopamine will decrease the level of melatonin. So you don't want to take melatonin supplement because it will make you feel less motivated. It will make you feel like you just sit down and don't do anything. So that's the effect of melatonin, and it can last for long. So if you want to avoid jet lag, there are many other things which you can do, but avoid melatonin as much as you can. So avoid viewing bright light between 10 p.m. and 4 a.m. This is actually related to the previous thing, because light is actually influencing the levels of melatonin in the body. And melatonin is actually very important to keep your sleep cycle intact. And as you know, during our sleep, our body tries to repair, and you actually grow in when you sleep. Even when you are adult, you are repairing the system which needs repairing. So you need a good night's sleep to function well in the day. And you need melatonin for that. But if you are exposing yourself to bright light during this 10 p.m. to 4 a.m. time, then you are actually not, your melatonin levels will not be high. You will not get a good sleep. So good sleep is actually described by the phases of how you are sleeping. Are you getting REM sleep? Are you getting deep sleep? And are you getting the phases of sleep? So 90 minutes, one phase. So all this is important for a good night's sleep. And everything is controlled by sleep. How good you are sleeping, then how active you are the next day. So avoid this time, the bright light. But for our work life, we can't avoid direct light during this time. So if you are working on a laptop, just go for a night mode or have a screen protector in front, or don't use overhead lights, use floor lamps instead. So these are the ways you can just little bit changes you can do it at your home lighting system, and that works fine. This for the coffee lovers is a good thing. Coffee is rich in caffeine, and caffeine is actually a booster for dopamine. So how it works, let me go into a little detail here, because I'm also a coffee lover, and every time there's a question like, is coffee good or coffee is bad? So here I'm giving you, but just remember, in the 100 to 400 mg, which is 2 or 3 cups, not more than that. So, and the timing of coffee is also important, and how well your body is metabolizing. So if you are taking a morning coffee, what it will do, it will be absorbed in the small intestine within an hour, and it will become available throughout the blood in most parts of the body, including your brain, within an hour. So as it starts entering your brain, it starts competing with adenosine. So adenosine makes you sleepy. Just remember that. So in this figure, you can see here below, these green ones are the adenosine, and they bind to this receptor. So it's like a key lock system. So adenosine is a key, and this blue thing, which is the receptor, is the lock. So adenosine will bind to this and it makes you sleepy. But when you take your morning coffee, so dopamine, as I said, it will give you motivation. It will give you a wakefulness. So when you are taking coffee, the caffeine will actually go on and then bind to the lock of these adenosines. So coffee is now competing with the adenosine. So less sleepy molecules and more wakeful molecules. So after 2 hours, you will get a jolt of wakefulness, which is because of the caffeine. And this will help you to promote the release of dopamine and glutamate. As you remember, I told you when dopamine works, glutamate is also being released. And glutamate is important for keeping your neurons healthy and your brain healthy. So that's why after drinking a coffee, you will feel good. But by early evening, most of the caffeine from your morning cup of coffee has metabolized. So the half-life, that is the amount of time it takes for the concentration of a substance to be halved. So in case of your metabolism, it will depend. So some people can drink in the evening and they will say that they can get a good night's sleep, and some people cannot. So it depends on the metabolizing enzyme you have in your liver, how fast it is metabolizing your caffeine. So after this is metabolized, you will start again feeling sleepy because your adenosine levels is going up and caffeine is going down. So this is how caffeine is increasing your dopamine level. Now the part two. Up till now, we have talked about how you can increase the dopamine. Now the important part is how you can manage the dopamine peaks, because as you remember in the first slide I talked about, you need persistence to keep the to do the job and keep doing it, and to you need the dopamine, you need to manage the dopamine levels in your body, because we know success breeds success. But if you don't manage the dopamine associated with the pursuit and your wins, your dopamine baseline and the dopamine you're experiencing from reaching milestone will start to diminish over time. And you will feel far less satisfaction from, well, everything. This is a common problem, but there are ways to overcome or even avoid it altogether. Leverage the power of dopamine released by reaching milestones to increase ongoing motivation. So how you can do this is by using this very efficient way of randomly intermittent reward timing, which is RIRT. So this is what casinos use, and it works every time. So you can use RIRT to your advantage to stay motivated in any pursuit. So how this works is, when you succeed in reaching a milestone, sometimes enjoy that, other times at random, just keep going. Even better, associate winning with the effort process itself. That's the holy grail of dopamine management for success. It won't make you dull or unhappy. It will make everything easier and more pleasurable. So without the peaks and valleys of dopamine, the external reward-driven people experience, and you will obtain the external rewards anyway. So to just simplify this, as I told you, dopamine is a molecule of anticipation. So sometimes you are anticipating and you are thinking the thought that this time maybe I'm winning, your dopamine levels will be high. And sometimes you celebrate your win, sometimes you don't. Just you associate that win with the effort you have put in. And this will keep your dopamine level active. As you can see in the figure, when dopamine when you are getting a reward is actually low, and dopamine when you are maybe getting a reward, like anticipating, it's much higher. So you can trick your brain in doing that. Next is to remember, dopamine is subjected, related to the first slide. So here, telling yourself that you are moving towards your goal is a huge stimulator of dopamine release, and it's under your control. It's not a placebo effect. It actually can happen because it is an anticipation molecule, as you can remember. But of course, you can't lie yourself. If you are not achieving something, your brain will know. Prefrontal cortex understands that. But if you are going towards a certain milestone, you can tell, you can look back and confirm that to yourself that you are achieving your goals. That's why you have heard this many times from many people, that break your goal into smaller goals and go for that. Don't go for that big goal. Just break it down and then go for these smaller goals. This is actually referred to as the belief effect, and it works well. The third is spotlighting. So it is proposed by Dr. Emily. She is a professor of psychology at New York University. And she discusses this as a spotlighting effect. Like, you are picturing your goal in your mind, and you are picturing your win, and you are not looking, you are not getting distracted, and you are totally focused on that particular goal. When you are doing that, even when you are thinking about it, you are actually increasing the neurotransmitters in your brain. So dopamine is released. With dopamine, epinephrine and other serotonin, other hormones are also released, which gives you that feeling of satisfaction, feeling of motivation. So this also works well. And the fourth important point is, don't layer too many sources of dopamine. So this is like, you will feel like you are actually doing it wrong, but it works. And if you are stacking too many dopamine triggering sources at one with the one effort, like if you are going to a gym and you are actually taking a coffee with you, whatever you like, coffee or any other drink you like, you are taking that, you're listening to music. So everything is giving you a dopamine spike. Exercise also is a dopamine trigger in your body. So when you are layering too many dopamine stimulating things at one point, you remember the pain, pleasure, pain balance. So when you are increasing the pleasure to a hike, you will feel the pain, you will feel the drop in the dopamine, and you will feel bad after doing a certain activity which has a stacked dopamine stimulators. So to avoid that, include that anticipation theory here. Sometime go with music, sometime don't go, sometime take coffee with you, sometime don't. So just change it up, and your brain will keep on guessing and anticipating, and you will feel the dopamine rise every time without the big crash after it. So this is the few things which you can do easily without investing in it. And these are easy to do, and you can just start with one and add on as you go. And if you want to read further, you can look for these books. These are very interesting and very easy books to read. And a lot of information. In our book club, we have discussed this book last month, Dopamine Nation, which is a very interesting read. If you want, you can go for this. And the Atomic Habits, like how to break the habits, how to form new habits, and how to continue doing it, is a very good book from James Clear. And this is Emily's book, which Dr. Emily, where spotlighting effect is described in detail. And Molecule of More is also all related to dopamine and how it can affect our body, with very interesting stories of patients who have dealt with dopamine dip and dopamine addiction. So yeah, now I stop my presentation here and I open the meetup for discussion and questions. So if you want to